And greetings, everyone, and welcome to another episode of the Wisdom Keeper podcast. Today, I am joined by Erik Jampa Anderson, a founder and director of the Sri Mala, and a scholar, practitioner of Soa Rigpa, colloquially known as Tibetan medicine. And we will unpack that term, I'm sure, in the course of this discussion. He is a graduate of the Shangshung Institute, and is, in my estimation, one of the rare and distinguished members of a small cohort of Western practitioners who have studied all four of the classic medical tantras. His first book, Unseen Beings, is due this year in spring of 2023. It is published by Hay House, and we are going to spend quite a bit of time unpacking his new release, as I have come to understand, as is the case with many of the first releases. It represents a large commitment of energy, effort, and time. And so we want to give this scholar practitioner his due and some nice respect for that commitment and energy in what is going to be revealed in that book. But before I get going, I just want to start with a little quote, Anderson, Erik, and get your feedback. It'll be a little bit of a curveball to start us off, if you don't mind. It'll also give me a chance to just really sort of contextualize a little bit of the Wisdom Keeper podcast. The quote is, "In order to go forward, we must go back."
Yeah. Well, thank you very much for having me. I'm really excited to be able to chat with you today from across the pond. I absolutely agree. I think it's interesting. I think it's less about going back on principle and more about going back as a practical ramification of where we're at the present moment. So I think we've made, using we very broadly here, I think we've made some mistakes over the past, let's say 3,000 years. I think that there have been particular moments where some societies, some people have veered off course from what I would describe as being our sort of true nature. And because of that, I think it's useful for us to look backwards, both to find the sort of ideological cause of those, you know, runoff moments, and also to see what we lost in the process. So, you know, I'm very, if I'm honest with myself, I'm definitely an antiquarian by nature. I tend to prefer old things. I tend to be very idealistic about the past, especially the ancient past. And I'm rational enough to know that that's not always well-founded. You know, we are very, we're very blessed to exist in the time and place that we exist in, you know, in part because we have such massive access to a vast array of different, you know, traditions of knowledge and systems of knowledge. So I think we're very fortunate to be where we are today. But, you know, this actually ties into something that I speak about quite frequently in regards to being a traditional medicine practitioner. You know, I identify my practice as a traditional medicine practitioner, not as an antiquarian sort of, you know, experiment of just doing things the old way. I don't think that that's really authentic to the ethos of traditional medicine. What I prefer is a mentality that is cumulative and that builds upon lineage and tradition. Mm-hmm. So instead of throwing away everything that came before right now, we can build upon that and, you know, continue interacting and engaging with some of the past realizations that we had in order to see how they can be, you know, fit into either in a positive sense or a negative sense, our prevailing modern paradigm. So for me, traditional medicine isn't alternative medicine, for instance. I think of these as very fundamentally different things. Alternative medicine tends to take a very oppositional stance that forms itself based on not being that. It's not the mainstream, it's the alternative. And I think that itself is a very reactive point of view that isn't super helpful or progressive in terms of science and the sort of cultivation of knowledge. Instead, I think more of a traditionally based, lineage-based approach is really valuable. So acknowledging that there are many things that we used to do and believe that we shouldn't do and believe anymore. And we can look at that in a sober way by, you know, comparing it with what we now more empirically know to be true. But if we just dismiss it on principle and say, oh, well, that came before we had X, Y, or Z, you know, rational paradigm, therefore it's useless, I think that that's really a missed opportunity. So in that sense, I think it's necessary that we look to the past in order to be able to move forward. We really have to, you know, we have to have a foot in the past, a foot in the future, and a third foot in the present in order to really be able to make progress in any real substantial way.
Beautifully put. Thank you so much. Yeah, I think we're in a little bit of an alignment with that because, of course, you know, being a healthcare provider myself, I love as much as I can get of the traditional lineages. But if I wasn't being honest, I think there's something that can always be added to augment and help and assist. And so, you know, trauma-informed approaches in psychotherapy are absolutely essential. The neuroscience has been really clear in delivering, you know, a kind of vote of confidence for some of the underlying mechanisms. So I just feel like, yes, absolutely. In order to provide a service now of whatever kind, being an integrative practitioner really widens the tool chest, if you will. I think the quote itself emerges from the origin story of the Wisdom Keeper podcast, which is really tied to the 2020 Jupiter-Saturn conjunction. And at that time, we were doing the contemplative studies program, the program that I direct. We were doing a long, intensive study on the Lamrim. And we were reading some of the astrology about what was sort of predictive. And it was about 2019, and we were reading Maurice Fernandez's synthesis of the Saturn-Jupiter conjunction. And it was written in 2016. And it really provided a lot of impetus for our work together because, in a way, we started preparing for COVID. We've prepared for the pandemic because we didn't know it was going to look like a pandemic. But I think the astrology really helped us understand the monumental paradigm shift we are now amidst.
Yeah.
And as the whole snow globe starts getting shaken up and the systems begin to collapse, and a resurgence of contemplation takes place, a deep retreat, whether it be personal, collective, sociological, societal, structural. One of the impetus for me was, in order to move forward out of this sort of dissolution, we're going to also really need to remember some of the things that we've lost that contributed to our societies getting too rigid and brittle.
Yep.
And that really includes people like you. The Wisdom Keeper really represents people who have steeped themselves in very profound teachings, but then have also taken the next step to make it applicable to the modern context. So that's where the quote comes from. And I think that's a great starting place because I'm sure your book and my new book all, in the terms of the introduction, I'm sure you take a wide angle lens of just to really look at where we are as a species and to substantiate, as the Buddha would from a diagnostic point of view, the tremendous amount of symptoms that we're now experiencing.
Yeah.
From its most broad sense and then all narrowing it down, I'm sure you narrow it down in many ways, first of all, just into the biology of someone, but maybe we can just start from the most wide angle view, like sitting back, if we were to sit back together and just wrap a little bit about the state of the world as you see it.
Yeah, I feel like it's interesting because I think a lot of us are feeling the sort of pull from various different places. So I think, I mean, just in folks that I've spoken to over the past couple of years, from wildly different walks of life, different fields professionally that they're engaged in, I've found that a lot of people are feeling drawn to a particular sort of matrix of issues and topics, especially pertaining to the state of the natural world. And most specifically, the experiences of non-human beings in the process of climate change and really ecological destruction. So for me, you know, the Anthropocene specifically, this is the topic. It's the elephant in every room. It cannot be ignored. It can't be bypassed. I thought about it for a second when you read the quote, because, you know, there's a sort of movement of folks that are trying to say, oh, we need to move past the Anthropocene and we're actually in the symbiocene, and it's actually typified by an era of, you know, symbiotic relationships between beings and so on. But that's super aspirational. That is completely, you know, forward looking and a bit idealistic. I think part of that looking back is really a sober reckoning with how we got to the very dark place that we're in right now. Mm. You know, humanity has gone just in our, you know, 200 plus thousand years as Homo sapiens. We've gone from being creatures of the earth to being cataclysmic, you know, terrors of the cosmos that are in many ways akin to the asteroid that wiped out the dinosaurs. You know, we're on that level of cataclysmic might. And that's what makes this the Anthropocene. It's not that it's the human era, like, you know, put the crown on us, you know, good job, humans, we won. Very much not that. It's only the Anthropocene because we're geological agents now. We have the capacity to destroy the planet, not only ourselves, but absolutely everyone else, with some exceptions, most likely, but a lot of other folks, you know, a lot of beings that are not humans. And I think that that's something that we really have to acknowledge really seriously. And it has to take priority in really all of our conversations. There's so many intersections between our fundamental ecological issues and the myriad other social issues that we're facing currently. You know, anthropocentrism and our fundamental delusion that the entire universe revolves around humans, that is both theoretically, philosophically, and genetically connected to concepts like androcentrism, the idea that men are the center of the cosmos. Mm-hmm. It's tied to concepts of race. It's tied to concepts of, you know, speciesism. All of these are in the same sort of network of biases based on this fundamental delusion that there is a central master identity and that everyone around them exists only to serve that master identity. So if we want to deal with racism on a real systemic level, if we want to deal with sexism on a really systemic level, then we also need to deal with anthropocentrism on a really systemic level. These are all fundamentally related, which of course we can see in a lot of, you know, eco-feminist critiques from folks like Val Plumwood, et cetera, you know, really understanding that this is a core delusion that we've been operating with for thousands of years, but it isn't our natural state. It's something that we cultivated over time. I think that's an important distinction that we have to make, because then it's fixable. You know, it's not a disease if it's the natural state of things. If it's a disease, then we can see its etiology, we can see where it's leading, and we can potentially treat it. That's how the Buddha approached suffering, and I think that that's how we need to approach our ecological crisis.
Erik, since you talk with so much passion about this, and you're directly, you know, pulling from the matrix of being in the book writing, maybe you can give us a little backstory, you know, on you and how, you know, how do you get to this topic? If you were to give us a specific sort of little bio, glimpse of your biography, how did you get here? What are the main beads in the mala that get you here interested in this subject?
Yeah, this has really been something that's formed slowly over the course of my entire life. And I, you know, through writing this book, I've had to sort of go through the memory book, so to speak, and try to sort of follow the strands that led me here. Because even for me, it was a bit out of the blue, not entirely, but, you know, a few years ago, I thought that I would be translating medical texts and, you know, teaching students about urine analysis and things like that at this point. I didn't expect that I'd be writing a book about, you know, animism and climate change or plant sentience.
I have to say that too, because just in our interaction, our short interaction the other day and me reaching out to you, like I was sort of going in one direction, but I had to be flexible because there's something just speaking through you right now. And it's possibly taking your career in a little bit of a different trajectory. Absolutely. Maybe not entirely disconnected, but that's a wonderful little backstory for our listeners. Just sort of what's that veer about? And also how does everything come to bear in the end just to influence and augment your interest. You know, like it's not wasted time. It's just, it's perfectly positioned you for this reveal.
Right. Yeah. I mean, it, in my early life, I think, you know, thinking back to it, I think one of my first really deeply influential relationships was with my family dog as a kid. We had an English Springer named Star. I was around 6 years old when we got her. And she was my best friend. You know, she was my closest relation, especially on a real emotional level, for years. And that relationship helped to sort of lay the groundwork for the possibility of a kind of relatedness, a kind of interaction with more than just humans, that there can be meaningful, emotionally fulfilling relationships that can come from cross-species interactions. Mm-hmm. And that was something that, you know, my parents didn't try to sort of squash that or, you know, get me to think of her as just being a dog and not a person. She was a person to me. She was more important than humans to my heart. You know, she was deeply integral to my sense of meaning and what was valuable in the world. So I consider that to be a really primary experience of enchantment. Defining enchantment, enchantment is hard to define, but understanding it as a somatic experience of connection and relationship with the more than human world. So mm-hmm. that experience with her was really formative. I also had a tragic experience in my childhood when my brother was killed, my half brother. He was beaten to death in California. We lived in New England. And that sort of also, you know, pushed me into a slightly more existential direction. In addition to dogs, which I was very obsessed with as a kid, being neurodivergent, I my life was a string of obsessions, essentially, and it still is. But dogs were definitely one of the first ones. And I was also very interested in magic, you know, spirituality, religion, mythology.
How old would you have been when your brother died?
I was eight. Yeah, it was 1999.
Do you remember how you, in the early days and weeks and months, years following, how you made sense of it?
Yeah,
like, I mean, what kind of imprint do you think it left?
It's interesting because I was already very interested in ghosts. I was interested in the afterlife. I was interested in concepts of heaven and hell. So having an experience of death more firsthand, actually seeing my brother, who was 21 at the time, laid out in a casket when I was 8 years old, that was really world altering. It made all of that sort of theoretical, interesting, spooky stuff much more, you know, in front of me, much more in my lap. I remember one time, actually with my godmother in California, we were there for the funeral. And she was also, you know, she is very interested in sort of spiritual things as well. And she had me do some automatic writing, trying to sort of channel him and see how he felt about wherever he was. And I remember, you know, she had sort of prompted me to ask him, you know, where are you? And he said he was in heaven. And, you know, I had to ask, you know, how do you like it there? And he, you know, him through me said, oh, I actually like it better here. It's better than being on Earth. And I knew at the time that this was inauthentic. You know, that wasn't, that was me, an eight-year-old kid, you know, doing this sort of writing experiment to sort of channel perhaps what I wanted to be the case. But I knew within me that that was fabricated to some degree. It wasn't, I didn't speak to him. He didn't, you know, tell me what to write. So I became really interested in what the reality actually was. And that pushed me in a much more existential direction quite quickly. I became a lot more interested in religious ideologies, both from Christianity, which I was sort of nominally raised in, and also other religious and spiritual traditions, which I also had an exposure to partially through my parents. So yeah, I grappled with it in a sort of, I grabbed the bull by the horns, so to speak, and tried to get to sort of the basis of what was really going on. I was also, not so long after this, my mother, who was quite ill for a while after my brother died, he was my half brother, her son, and her only other son. So it was really quite a harrowing experience for her and for our family. But about a year or two later, she gave me a copy of The Hobbit by J.R.R. Tolkien. And, you know, I think it was, you know, she wanted me to sort of get my mind off of it, I suppose, but she also knew that I would like it. It was a favorite from her own childhood. So she gave me that. And I would say that was the biggest, you know, sort of ignition point for my spiritual journey, which is, you know, continued all the way to right now. It was really my exposure to Tolkien's works. And that was something that, you know, even though it's unrelated in a certain sense to my brother passing, it was the next step in that existential journey, in an attempt to find meaning, in an attempt to sort of get to a deeper layer of existence that could deal with topics of death, that could deal with topics of grief and loss and life in a really in an enchanted way, in a dynamic way.
Oh, open the door to Tolkien for us. Like, give us a little more into that world. What you discovered, and don't be shy. I mean, if it really took you out and beyond the box, give us some of that numinous experience that you may or may not have had.
Yeah, I consider myself to be Buddhist by religion and sort of Tolkienist by myth. You know, his works are my mythic foundation, which is something that we all had. we all had this for a very long time, even in traditions where, you know, there was an established religious paradigm. The myths that informed a cultural identity or an individual's identity weren't necessarily just from that. You know, we have cultural myths and deep ancestral myths that go back many thousands of years that have informed our existence in really direct ways. They're things that we relate to over the course of our entire life. They're things that inform our social dynamics, but also the way that we perceive ourselves, the way we perceive our place in the world, the way we perceive other beings. This is very frequently narrated through myth. And in the modern world, we've sort of lost that. We think that, you know, myth is something that is a commodity. It's a story, and it's something that you can consume an endless amount of, and the more the better. We treat stories as very much sort of single use commodities. But there's many stories that were never intended to be that. They were intended to be something that you absorb slowly and carefully over a long period of time. And for each of us, we might have a different body of myth that speaks to us. For me, it was Tolkien's works that really did that. It introduced a sort of layer of enchantment onto phenomenal reality, which was both accessible and also distinctly otherworldly. You know, Tolkien, I don't know if people are sort of publicly very aware of what Tolkien really did, but Tolkien was a philologist. His background was really in comparative philology, philology being the study of the evolution, development, and relationships between languages. So as opposed to just studying one language or one linguistic tradition and understanding that fully, a comparative philologist looks at many different related languages and looks at the connections between them, in part to be able to reassemble what their ancestral forebears might have been. So it's from this philological process that we get things like Proto-Indo-European, which is the cultural and linguistic tradition that was practiced 6,000 years ago and spoken 6,000 years ago by the ancestral traditions that give us Vedic Sanskrit in India and also the Norse traditions, Germanic traditions, Italic, Persian, Albanian, you know, all kinds of different linguistic and cultural traditions. So that's sort of what philologists were doing. For Tolkien, he was really interested in the connection between language and mythology. For him, these were intimately connected. Our languages tell stories themselves. Every word that we use and the way that it relates with other words, that tells a story. So for him, also, I expect being a very neurodivergent individual, he saw the stories in the words. He heard the stories in the words. They were themselves a source of evidence for him, a source of data, something that he could mine for information that he could use to sort of fill out the contours of the world. His main background was in Germanic traditions, Anglo-Saxon and Norse traditions especially. That's usually how people remember him. But he wasn't just that. He was fluent in, you know, probably close to a dozen different languages. I don't know if that's quite true, but he was fluent in many languages and at least well-versed in much more than a dozen. And he had a working knowledge of everything from, you know, the sort of contours of Sanskrit all the way to, you know, the Semitic tradition, Germanic tradition, Celtic traditions, and so on. So All that to be said, what he was pulling from in his creation of his legendarium, of his mythos, was historical in nature. It was linguistic and historical in nature. He really underwent a process of mythic reconstruction in a similar way that a philologist might reconstruct a language. He went in and tried to recreate something from the core roots of our various mythological traditions across the globe. And he did that not as a sort of scientific process that could be published in a paper as if it's, you know, a proto-religion that we could identify as historically real. He was really fascinated with the actual process of mythogenesis, the experience of enchantment, the experience of what he terms fairy, which informs a creative expansion upon those foundations. So he put himself in the process. His own experience of enchantment and his own creative process was for him a kind of scientific experiment. It was a process of looking at, you know, okay, these are the pieces that you're given. These are the different components that we begin with, and then create from there, see what comes out of it organically. And his mythos is what comes out of that. You can read works like the Silmarillion within the context of Proto-Indo-European mythology, within the context of Finnish Finno-Ugric mythology, and you can see the correlations between them. You can see how it's really embedded in a particular time and place within our human experience. So all that to sort of justify his place as more than just a fantasy writer, because he was so much more than that. He was really one of the preeminent 20th century scholars in the study of fairy stories and the study of mythology. He really understood fairy stories specifically, which are myths without the political agenda in many cases. He understood that much better than I think anyone else of the past few centuries, at least. So his work is really valuable.
It sounds like he was on, you know, a Joseph Campbell sort of tier, and yet probably didn't get the credit that you're, you know, opening my eyes to, at least. He's really credited as a story maker or the author of the series of books. But like the way you're describing him, a great synthesizer of world history and knowledge and language, and really this, the mythopoetic dimension of life, which I think both you and I share, is so absolutely essential. Let me ask you, as a young person now, you're 9, 10 at this point where you get the book.
Yeah.
And having given an homage to Tolkien in such a beautiful way just then, thank you so much for that. In such a young person's mind, how do you think you were actually making sense and using it? In what way was it moving you?
Yeah, it was my first exposure to a comprehensive body of knowledge, something that really echoes in many ways like the Vedic tradition or even potentially the biblical tradition. But I mean, personally, I think that Tolkien's work was a lot more earnest, certainly more earnest than Joseph Smith. You said Joseph Campbell, but I thought Joseph Smith when you said that, because also very, very similar. He spoke of his work as a kind of revelatory process. Mm-hmm. Also not dissimilar to what we have in the Terma tradition. Trungpa actually, who I don't quote frequently, I'm not a big Trungpa fan, but one of his students told me that he said in a presentation, you know, decades ago, that Tolkien was a kind of Tertan and that Lord of the Rings was a kind of Terma. And I think that that's, it's quite a statement to make.
Wow.
But when you really look at the process, I think more than Terma, it really aligns with the Gesar epics. He's very similar to the Bupdrung of Tibet, who are the revelatory bards who, you know, were once characters in Gesar's life story back in the, you know, 11th century. And then in modern times they're reincarnated as these bards that tell the story and they reveal chapters of the story in their life from this sort of liminal space. And that I think is very, 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 very similar to what Tolkien did. He talks about lucid dream experiences. He talks about revelatory experiences. He speaks of, you know, charter myths and framing stories that help to situate it within the present world. He does all of that. So I certainly think that he did a lot more than people realize. And part of, you know, it's a blessing and a curse that we have a work like Lord of the Rings, because it is so phenomenal and a brilliant myth for the Anthropocene in particular. But it does, the popularity of it and the commercial value of it blinds us a little bit. Yeah, to really the academic and philosophical prowess of what Tolkien brought to the table. So for me as a kid, you know, I was experiencing this body of work primarily through The Hobbit and then The Lord of the Rings, but which then spoke to this whole mountain of knowledge that underlaid it. And that was something that I could, you know, start to sort of chip away at by engaging with other materials. And then finding The Silmarillion and other works that were really from his heart corpus, you know, if the sort of Tolkien Ningtik, if we're going to that extent, you know, those were life altering.
In what way? I'm trying to nail you down here. Let me be more transparent. You and I both share this idea, and it's not just us. I mean, it's a growing kind of consensus that we've lost touch with the mythopoetic dimension of life, that we become too reductionistic in our thinking, and that actually a whole telltale, you know, symptomology is expressing itself right now, whether it be in individual symptoms or collective societal symptoms. This is going to lead eventually to your book, but just now in this phase of your life, young person having met the most stark existential challenge a family could face, here is a living embodied example of how mythopoetics reshapes, transforms. And I want to get a real flavor for that.
Yeah.
In your personal life.
I think there were two streams that came from this point. There was a stream that was looking for philosophical and religious truth. And that is something that at 9, 10 years old, I did start to apply onto Tolkien's work. I did, you know, before I ever became Buddhist, I was making offerings to Varda Elentari, the queen of the stars, and to Yavanna Kementari, and, you know, the queen of the earth. And I was engaging on that sort of level. But then there was the other side of it. That lineage eventually got largely replaced by Buddhism just a few years after. But there was another side to it that was the immediate perception of the phenomenal world. Tolkien's work, what's enchanting about Tolkien's work isn't the gods and goddesses. It isn't the cosmogenesis story. Those are all enchanting. But the real magic of his work is in the enchantment of simple and ignoble phenomena. You know, the simple enchantment of a forest or a river or a hill or an ancient ruin or, you know, the stars themselves, just the immediate experience of seeing the stars. There's something that he brings to his work that allows these ignoble things to become ennobled, to become enchanted in and of themselves. You know, he speaks of this quite a bit very directly, that, you know, just his treatment of trees, it's not the central point of the narrative. It's not, you know, it's, there's the Ents, you know, attacking Isengard and all of that. That's important to the Lord of the Rings story, but it's not the central point. No one would say that the moral of the Lord of the Rings is that trees are alive, but trees are alive. And that's a basic assumption that's brought into the underlying framework that all of those stories are built from. So I went from reading The Hobbit and Lord of the Rings to looking at the world around me with entirely different eyes. It was the simple features of the natural world that took on this basic level of enchantment. So, I mean, you know, when my friends were you know, reading superhero comics and playing video games and things like that, I was actively engaging with the natural world. My friends and I would go and build forts in nature and make maps of our neighborhood with, you know, their sort of, you know, sort of created original names, and, you know, to speak of the different beings that inhabit the different hills and forests and rivers and so on. That became a part of my lived reality because he opened that up in such a phenomenal way. But again, it's not in the stories, it's in the world in which they were told. You know, people don't realize that Middle Earth is just an old, it's a very old, especially Germanic term for the inhabited Earth. It's not different than where we are. Midgard in the Norse tradition, Middle Earth literally in the English tradition, this is just the world of humans. And specifically not the world of humans in an anthropocentric sense, but just where we live, it's here. Mm-hmm. And many authors throughout thousands of years of history have spoken of the same enchanted world as the domain in which stories take place. All he did was open that up again for a 20th century audience. And within that world, there's everything. It's not just about gods and spirits and elves and dwarves. It's also about the enchantment of nature itself, the enchantment of the normal features of the world in which we exist. And that's really where the magic comes, in my opinion. You know, my and I'll come to my spiritual path in a minute, I suppose. But, you know, it's been a very sort of roundabout path to get back to just nature as it is. And I think that it's no surprise, really, that so many of the ways that we personify the nature of mind, the sort of our basic nature, the ground of being, have so many linguistic correlates with nature itself. We can basically take the same, very profound and lofty statements, returning to our basic nature, and apply that very directly and objectively onto nature as the environment. It is a return to our true nature. It is a return to just the way things are, and recognizing the natural luminosity of that. But that's something that we can come to through meditation and practice. And it's also something that we can really inform through mythology, which of course we do in the Buddhist tradition as well. But I don't think all myths work for everyone. We have to really find what speaks to us.
It's brilliant. Yeah. So, and do you think the actual death of your brother itself was reconceptualized, was sort of alchemically allowed to take on a different kind of meaning?
I don't know if Tolkien allowed for that to happen. I think Buddhism definitely allowed for that to happen. For me, my brother's death was something that constantly remained as an existential fire under my ass, I suppose. It was a direct acknowledgement of mortality, especially premature mortality, him dying at 21.
And also brutally the way he was, he was murdered.
Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, that's if it's a car crash or, maybe an illness, it's different, but that was a brutal, occurrence.
Absolutely. And that was something that I continued to grapple with and to try to make sense of, I think, into my more formal sort of spiritual life once I found the Dharma. But it, the Tolkien experience for me was primarily, it was an enchanting of my experience of reality. And that never went away. That was something that remained. Once I got switched into that mode of experiencing the world, it never really stopped. And it remains a really core foundation of how I experience the world to this day. I mean, the whole reason that I came to England in the first place and even considered this being a place that I would want to live was really inspired by the love of the English countryside that Tolkien instilled in me. But it's not limited to just one place. It's a way of looking at the phenomenal world as a whole that allows us to be integrally, engaged and in relationship with other beings. So that remains a really prominent theme of my work today, more so I think now today than it was a few years ago.
Let me ask you, if you were, as you look out, maybe young people and maybe a little older than you were then, but teenagers, high schoolers that don't have the mythopoetic lens come online for them, that are been raised in a very reductionistic paradigm, what kind of subjective experience do you think that they are, having as a result? Like, what does it look like to miss out on that? And, just sort of putting ourselves in their shoes, how would we know? And for example, like, it's not that video games and DC comic movies are not there. So then what's still missing, do you think?
Right. Reminds me of something that Russell Brand said, actually, in relation to sort of 12-step recovery. He basically says, we're in a program, you're in a program whether you like it or not. You either choose to be in a program or you choose to not be in a program. Him speaking about recovery. You're in a program no matter what. It's just a matter of whether you're actually engaging some degree of agency and wisdom in choosing which one to follow. And it's the same for myths. The entirety of our human culture, of our human societies as a whole, every single feature of our human societies are codified in myth. Our whole ability to relate on a social level with a large number of people is dependent upon myth. We have a basic biological limitation for how many relationships we can have. And the only way that we can go beyond that is through the establishment of common myth. So definitely there's not a person alive today, from, a hardcore evangelical Christian to a total secular atheist, who isn't currently living in some sort of a mythic construct of reality. But then the dynamics, what that myth holds, can vary very widely. So, someone who is living in a reductive mythological sort of construct of reality, their possibilities for engagement, for satisfaction, for a sense of meaning are going to be limited by that.
So in this context, you're saying that science is a myth too, scientism.
To an extent, you know, the empirical level of science is not itself mythic, but then the theory that comes out of that,
right,
you know,
the belief, the yeah. dogma that follows the scientific method, let's say.
Yeah.
It's like chased, like a beer in a shot. It's chased with its own mythology. But right. what you're saying is that, number one, what I'm hearing is that it's so implicit that it can't be self-selected or volitionally chosen. And two, there is a degree of difference between myths in terms of their practical application, what they can actually yeah. substantially provide.
And also their origins. You know, not all myths are created equal. There's a lot of myths, especially a lot of the myths that underlie our dominant world religions. A lot of those are politically contrived. There's elements, at least many layers of those bodies of knowledge, which were contrived in what I think is a sort of inorganic way. They were contrived with a specific purpose in mind to get people to believe a certain thing or to think about history in a certain way. And that's not really the same thing as what Tolkien was doing, for instance. You know, Tolkien's process was an organic sort of revelation which had no political or religious ambitions, which is why it never devolved into a religion. I do mm-hmm. think that probably a couple hundred years from now, I think there is going to be people who follow Tolkienism as a religion, because once you separate yourself by enough space, those things become very, very standard. There isn't a single body of mythic literature similar to his that was produced in the past that didn't devolve into a kind of religious movement. So I think that could happen in the future, but that was never his ambition in the slightest.
Same with maybe Star Wars.
Yeah. I mean, Star Wars, I'm not a giant Star Wars fan, so I can't really speak to it on the same level, but definitely, you know, there's these things will eventually, I think, manifest in different ways. But I think that overall, this century is going to renegotiate our relationship with religion overall. And hopefully we'll see that religion itself is somewhat unnecessary. It's a biological benefit for us to have these systems because they facilitate group cohesion, they bring us together, they give us a sense of value and meaning and community, but we can accomplish those things in other ways. What we can't sacrifice is myth. Myth is always going to be there. So we can either subscribe to a myth of reductionism and materialism and capitalism and so on, or we can subscribe to myths of, you know, Genesis theory and heaven and hell and God and Satan and so on.
We can sin, original sin.
Yeah, exactly. These are mythic constructs that we use to identify our place in the world, our relationship with other beings, and to give ourselves that sense of understandable meaning. Our human brains, we don't operate on the level of data.
I've never had someone on the show say that they think that myth is more indispensable than religion itself. That's really beautifully put it. That's a profound assertion.
I don't know if I can stand by it if someone were to pick it apart, but I do think that this is the case. You know, ultimately we can have science, mythology, and religion all at once. You can be someone who simultaneously has a religious faith, has a belief in science, a trust in the scientific process, and has myths that inform their way of living in the world. I think of those three, the only one that's at all expendable is religion. Mm-hmm. And speaking of religion in its most sort of strict organized sense, obviously there's elements of religion that aren't so, you know, dispensable. And our worldview is often sort of, you know, wrapped up in that little package of religion, and that intersects with myth and science in important ways. But I think ultimately on a societal level, what we really need is more engagement and collaboration between science and storytelling, because we don't understand reality, most of us. I don't understand reality through facts and figures and numbers. I understand it once it becomes translated into something that we can really engage with on a more psychic level, which is story. You know, that's really what fills the sort of, you know, blank space between our sensory input and our behavioral output. It's how we, you know, embed it through the operating system of our myth, of our sort of mythic view of reality. So without that, science isn't going to be very, very useful for us. You know, we've had a lot of really robust scientific revolutions, even just over the past 50 years, that have done absolutely nothing to impact the way that we actually exist in the world. Yeah. And that's something that I think, it's not a breakdown of science. I don't think that the scientific process is a myth. I think that empirical observation should be the foundation of the way that we approach the world, but it needs to be contextualized, embedded, and embodied through a body of story and myth and narrative. That's what allows us to make sense of how we fit into it. You know, the standard model of particle physics, that's a myth. The empirical observation of particles, that's not a myth necessarily, that's observation. But then the standard model is in fact a mythic construct, which is inherently mutable. And that's something that's very useful about the scientific side of things, is that it is mutable, is that scientists are willing, even if begrudgingly so on some things, they are willing to acknowledge that they're wrong and to then, you know, go into a new reality. That's something that we don't always have in religious traditions, which I do think is very, very dangerous.
So the widespread apathy among youth, the incidence of depression, which is at epidemic levels, the suicide attempt, put those into context and tie them to this thesis you're putting forward about the loss of myth.
Yeah, I mean,
help the ordinary person who may be listening right now, who's either, you know, young and impressionable and having a very difficult time. Maybe there are parents out there that have their own qualms and difficulties navigating the world and that of their families or children. They haven't quite yet come up into the mythological dimension of life. They're struggling. How do you make a connection between the vast symptoms, challenges that we're seeing, and the absence of mythology?
Yeah, I obviously think that they're deeply related. I'm also really, I think it's important not to pathologize those symptoms themselves. You know, people feeling alienated, feeling depressed, feeling anxious, feeling—
it's totally appropriate.
That is the appropriate response. That is the only appropriate response. You know, I'm really, really resistant to any sort of worldview that tells people, you know, to just not worry or just don't think about it or, you know, just remain positive, you know, don't focus on the negative, just try to, you know, focus on your blessings and so on. It's such a process of bypassing. Those responses are themselves the healthy response. That is what we need to be having. And I do think that there's a sense of empowerment that comes from recognizing that. You know, I definitely, as a young person especially, but even as an adult, I've always struggled with anxiety and depression and, you know, senses of you know, deep existential angst and woe. And that's natural, that's appropriate. That is the appropriate reaction to have. And acknowledging that and giving ourselves space for that is, I think, a much more, it's a much healthier way of processing it. And myth can give us the sort of framework to be able to look at that constructively, to be able to make sense of it, and also to get us out of the isolation that our social constructs and our current social myths have established for us. You know, it's crazy making to think that our entire lives are only built around, you know, making money, spending money, saving a bit of money so you can spend it later, go to work, give away, you know, the majority of your sort of vital years to someone else to make them rich, and then still never be able to afford any of the things that you were told that you'd be able to afford by the time you were this age. All of this, it's deeply, deeply depressing, and it's not okay, but it's a symptom of a broken system. It's not our own brokenness that, you know, makes us feel depressed in those situations. The overarching myths that we live by today, namely, you know, anthropocentrism, capitalism, these are stories that are designed to make us miserable. They're stories that will always leave us feeling isolated and unfulfilled and unhappy. That's part of how they operate. But we don't have to settle for isolation. We can have relationship. We can have real interaction and meaningful, substantive engagement with the natural world and with each other. And that is built around myth and ceremony. These are things that we've always had that have always brought us together and given us a sense of meaning that we've really largely just destroyed. You know, we've replaced that communal spirit that arises from those things with really rampant individualism. And of course, individualism would lead to a sense of isolation. That's its natural sort of intended consequence. So now that we've seen that, that's miserable and that we don't want that, we can all actively work to create a new reality, because there's, you know, no one among us is really fully satisfied with the way things are. Even those at the very top, you know, they're not satisfied with the way things are, especially when you look at folks like celebrities, you know, artists sensitive people who think that, you know, stardom and fame and success is going to sort of meet their needs. But then these very sensitive people get to the top and realize that their entire lives have been sacrificed in the process. And unsurprisingly, a lot of them destroy themselves. They, you know, they go through a process of self-destruction. So we don't need to think that that is where the answers lie. That, you know, if we just follow the status quo and play the game well, that we'll succeed. You know, it's the basic Buddhist teaching on, you know, not following the eight worldly dharmas.
The worldly wins, right? Yeah, yeah.
Okay, I hope that's a helpful response.
I think
things that I could say to that, but
yeah, it's wonderful, because I think, you know, we just opened up a small little portal in your biography, and we got into the profundity here. So. Thank you for that. Let me ask you then, you know, just as we inch closer to your book, and of course, these threads are interwoven with your book, so it's not like we're, you know, we're covering the ground of the book in a way too, but we'll make a more concerted effort to consolidate the understanding of the book by giving it this background here. What's the next bead in your mala in terms of, it may actually be your entrance into Buddhism, I would suspect, after Tolkien.
Yeah. Yeah. And I do want to say one thing before we go too far past Tolkien and myth, even though I'm sure we'll come back to it. But something that I think is really valuable for us to look at, it was a comment made by Ursula Le Guin, who is a great, you know, myth writer and literary critic herself. And she made a comment essentially that fantasy, what we term fantasy, which is the mythic mode of writing of yesteryear, but today we think of it as fantasy because it's a, you know, it's a different sort of world, and it's an artistic realm where you can create something and sell it and whatever. But fantasy, what fantasy does for us, what myth does for us, what fairy stories do for us, is gives us the possibility to consider the non-human as essential. It's the only narrative genre that we really allow that to take place in. And if you think about that, it's really a bit jarring. You know, you can watch hundreds of movies and read hundreds of books that are, you know, serious dramas that get to the core of what it means to be human. And all of them might completely bypass any non-human characters. There might be absolutely no involvement of animals, plants, environment. There's no real sense that those beings also have a presence in the world of the human. And that's something that's really, I think there's a direct correlation between that and our ecological crisis. I think it's a glaring connection at that. And that's something that we can only really overcome by getting past our discomfort with these more mythic and fantastical modes of storytelling. Myth is the sort of, you know, sophisticated way for us to deal with that and still feel good about ourselves. But, you know, for folks that engage with fantasy more directly, there's benefit in that as well. It doesn't have to be only some lofty, you know, mythic work that only a great seer is able to divine from the cosmos. You know, yes. Even engaging with fantasy, writing fantasy stories, writing fairy tales, writing stories about your trees or your garden or your animals, that is a part of our sort of recovery process as a species. It's what can bring us closer to a real relationship with the more than human world. So I just wanted to say that.
No, that's beautifully put. You know, the association that's coming up for me was around, it's because I'm devouring Jung right now, but Jung's emphasis on active imagination is, that's what it feels like to me about opening up a portal where you're in the mythic realm of your collective unconscious. And there are a multiplicity of dimensions of beings.
Yeah.
And that is actually a necessary threshold to enter into in order to really begin a process of integration, or what you and I might call reclaiming what has been lost. There's no way to do it simply from the, you know, left prefrontal cortex. There's no way to do an analysis about it. They're really what is required. I guess this is one of the profound things you were saying about Tolkien, is there needs to be another language. There needs to be another land bridge in our brain hemispheres. There needs to be a railway system into the body, And then there needs to be a sort of portal that opens up multiple dimensions with entities, other beings, in order to foster this greater sense of connection, which we have lost. So that's what I'm picking up on when you're talking about this. Well, I'm sorry I interrupted you, but I'm just riffing it.
Oh, absolutely.
It feels really resonant.
Absolutely. And I think an important point, which I love Jung and Joseph Campbell, but I think an important foil for especially Joseph Campbell's perspective is that it's not all just human. You know, these fairy stories and myths are not just allegories. Allegory kills enchantment. Allegory is a cynical literary device, in Tolkien's opinion, and I share this opinion quite strongly, because it always keeps us a step removed. It always keeps us hyper aware of the fact that this isn't real and that it's simply talking about things that are real, which are almost always human affairs.
Right. Subjugated by the analytic mind, in other words, allegory.
Exactly. And it distances us from the enchantment that is being used. It keeps it as strictly a literary and sort of an imaginative device, as opposed to a portal to another way of seeing things. Yeah. And that's not to say that the opposite is then true, that they're historical real accounts of how things actually are. Of course, that's ridiculous. That's not what it is either. But the enchantment that it fosters can't be only an allegorical device. Otherwise, it's automatically limited. Yeah. What it is applicable. It's perennially applicable. Works like Homer's Odyssey or the Mahabharata or the Eddas of the Norse world or the, you know, Mabinogion or the Kalevala or Tolkien or whatever. These are applicable systems of myth that we can apply to any situation in our lives. We can apply it to our relationship. You can apply it to current political situations. You can apply it to climate change. And you should be able to then get something out of it. It helps to clarify some dynamics of that situation. That's the applicability of myth, as opposed to myth's role as an allegory, which I think is somewhat limiting. You know, it's interesting, speaking of Campbell, actually, you know, just our perception that most myths sort of follow this fixed archetypal model of like the hero with 1,000 faces, you know, that is partially a result of our sort of anthropocentric bias. It's actually not all stories that we've told historically have been stories about a human hero overcoming supernatural foes to get some sort of, you know, magic treasure and appease the gods and so on. There were many different kinds of stories that we told, countless different kinds of stories. And most of them really involved our human relationship with the more than human world. That was such a core component for so many mythic traditions, oftentimes to clarify the basic kinship between beings. Mm. And that's a piece that we've somewhat lost in the psychologization of myth, even though I think the Jungian and Campbellian approach is very useful and very valuable. I think Jung's quote specifically, we don't become enlightened, one does not become enlightened by imagining figures of light, but by making the darkness conscious. That's one of my very favorite quotes in the world. And I think is a really sort of core pith instruction, both for some of these processes and also for some of what we do in Buddhism.
Yes, beautiful. Beautiful. Would you like to jump into your Buddhist training? And maybe there we can get a through line into where we are today.
Totally. So my sort of wanderings through various fields of spiritual inquiry and myth and so on led me down a few different rabbit holes. When I was in middle school, obviously being very, very passionate about Tolkien was not the coolest thing for someone in my sort of age range to be doing. There was one day, I can't believe I'm about to say this. There was one day in sixth grade when I went to school and I had adhered fake hair to my feet. I had some like polyester, like golden locks that I had spirit gummed to my feet. And I like put on my shoes and, you know, went to school. And I decided to show someone in my homeroom that I was really a hobbit. See, I have proof, look at my feet. And it was the worst choice I ever made because I was bullied relentlessly for months and months thereafter. Of course, as any, you know, kid with a sense of humor would do, that's perfect fodder for ridicule. But that led to a lot of really difficult times for me emotionally, because I was very much alienated and isolated from my peers. And I was the single topic of everyone's ridicule for a long time. So I eventually decided to switch schools. And I left the public school system and went to a private Catholic school, where I had a beehive put in my desk and struggled a lot with the nuns. So I left the Catholic school and then I went to a Seventh-day Adventist school, which is where I stayed for 2 years. And this was really, that's the sort of background for then my my disenchantment with Christianity and ultimate denouncement of Christianity and then going into something else. So I found in that environment, you know, we were taught all kinds of things in religion class. We were taught that Satan hid dinosaur bones in the crust of the earth in order to convince people that the earth was more, you know, more than 6,000 years old. You know, we were taught about the part of the head specifically that receives God's blessings as a part of a sort of like religious anatomy lesson. And obviously all of the rhetoric about heaven and hell and the exclusivity of Christianity as the only method of averting eternal damnation and torture in hell. And this wasn't working for me.
Well,
it's
these kinds of introductions that I think could lead us to a very quick conclusion that this is the example of the religion that is dispensable.
This is precisely an example of that. You know, I don't know. I think that, you know, Tolkien was a Catholic. He was very much found, you know, grounded in Christian theology. He included an omnipotent thrice omni God, but who was very disinvolved as a component of his core mythos. But he did that quite intentionally as a Catholic. I do think that Christianity can lead to genuine experiences of the nature of mind, because obviously I think we would have to be really, really deeply self-absorbed to think that only our tradition is able to foster an experience of the nature of things as they are. It's a delusional sectarian sort of superiority conceit. So I don't think that that's the case, but I definitely don't think that, you know, Christianity as received through the Holy Bible is comparable in any way, shape, or form to other spiritual traditions of the world, namely, you know, Buddhism, Taoism, Hinduism, Jainism, you know, even more mystical forms of Judaism. It's just incomparable. It was formed for completely different reasons. There were distinct political and social, you know, MOs that underlaid the development of Christian theology and biblical, you know, mythology that weren't necessarily present in the same ways for something like Buddhism. So yeah, it's that worldview, which also isn't Christianity's fault. They got the heaven-hell dualism probably from Zoroastrianism and partially from ancient Greek traditions, but they knew what they were doing in including those concepts in the formation of a new world religion, because it's terribly compelling and it's terrifying. And, you know, it took me years, even after abandoning Christianity and feeling very solid in my Buddhist practice, it took me years to get over the fear of hell. And then it took me many more years to realize that Buddhism also...
Well, yeah, they have their own version, don't they? Yeah, especially when you get into... They have that fire and brimstone talk when you get into Vajrayana too.
They had hundreds of years before Christianity did. You know, the Vajrayana hells, that's a later edition, which is absolute nonsense, in my opinion. It's pure bullshit.
But it serves the same function, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And there's psychological trauma that then results from that, especially as a queer person. I mean, God. You know, I didn't know I was queer when I was in this Christian school, but I knew I was different. And I knew that I was different to a degree that would then alienate me from the promised results of Christianity. So I wasn't having it. I basically spent all of my free time on the, you know, dial-up internet, looking up contradictions and you know, problems in the Bible and recording them in my little notebooks. And I went to religion class one day where we had a pastor who would come in every week and teach us about religion. And I pulled out my notebook and I started going through and just tossing out challenges at him and being like, well, this verse says that women shouldn't speak in church. Why do you say that that's okay? You know, this verse says that you're not supposed to, you know, mix fabrics, the classic, you know, Leviticus critiques. And I just kept going. I went all the way through, you know, contradictions between the different gospels and so on. And eventually he stopped me, had me leave the class, and I was suspended for, I think, 3 days for that outburst, which is a badge of honor that I wear very proudly now. But at the time, you know, that was problematic. I was, you know, only 12 years old, I think, 13 years old at the time, and really, you know, being quite inflammatory.
Yeah.
So eventually I decided that I wasn't Christian. I couldn't be Christian. I didn't believe in the historicity of the Bible, which for me was really important. Understanding that the way that they told us things came about and that things were recorded was not actually historically true. That was a major moment of realization for me. And it remains a major moment of realization for me, even in the Buddhist tradition, you know, recognizing that there's certain myths and stories that we perpetuate in the Buddhist tradition, like Vajra Hell, which are indeed myths that are not useful, are not empirically founded, and are really manipulation tools. That itself, the historical context itself, is very liberating. I think that that's something that we need to allow ourselves to engage with, to recognize where our beliefs really come from.
I'm slowly putting things together. If you don't mind me just making a little bit of interpretation, seeing if it lands for you. Here are the little symbols I've collected. There's only a couple of them. One, you mentioned doing rituals before you had Tolkien. You must have set up an altar and you were making rituals to this one or that one. I've got that little nod. Then you add this other piece of, you had Tolkien, the world that Tolkien opened up. Then the gluing the hair to your toes or your feet. I honestly, because I was asking you the frame of reference that mythology provides is liberative. What does it liberate from? The sheer certainty and granularity and automaticity of reductionism. And your soul must already be atypical in the sense that it is already primed to the world of magic at such a young age. Otherwise, you wouldn't gravitate towards to these things. But right there, I think one of the things I was asking is, like, how does it work? The fact that you could have easily been swallowed like your peers by the religiosity. And this kind of symptomology that both you and I agree, symptoms are expressions of the soul beckoning for our attention. It's giving us knowledge and guidance. It's heeding us a warning of what it needs. The fact that you were pushing back on religion and the fact that you're pushing back on these stories, I cannot help tie these threads together to sort of substantiate how myth had already dislodged you and gave you that observing capacity to see from another perspective just how confining and ridiculous it all is.
Yeah, absolutely. And
so I love the hair on your feet, because you're already living in the world as a different kind of being. And maybe at the time, you know, it wasn't accepted, but you were still pushing the boundaries.
Yeah, exactly.
And you were listening to something. And I think, oh my God, how liberative would it be for so many more people right now, young people, to have a dose of the magic so that they could at least begin to dissolve some of the conviction that imprisons them.
Yeah.
So I think it must have saved your life in a way.
Oh, it definitely saved my life. Tolkien and Buddhism saved my life. I would not be alive today if not for those two things in my life, their presence in my life. I think
One working on the other, because listen, you could fall into Vajra Hell, you could fall into totalitaristic Buddhism, you could fall into 100%. you didn't fall into the Christianity pit of fire, you didn't fall into the Buddhist austerity and, like, you know, its own form of dogmatism.
Or maybe you dabbled. I dabbled a bit, and which you can see that tendency in my psyche, which is something that I was hyper conscious of. I was looking for a religion. You know, when I decided I wasn't Christian anymore, I was able to do that because I had tasted something else, and that something else was so much richer, so much more enchanting, so much more meaningful, and fulfilling than anything I had ever experienced in Christianity itself. So knowing that that was there, and knowing that that was a fictitious world, something that had been created, I knew the profundity of it from Tolkien's scholastic background, but I didn't fully get it. I was a kid, but I knew that that was something that was much richer than what I had. So I knew that there had to be more out there. And when I left Christianity behind, I actively was searching for a religion. I knew I wanted to be religious. You know, I initially went and looked at Catholicism because I was raised Protestant. So I was like, maybe the saints will fix it. And it didn't really do it. And then I looked into Judaism, and yeah, that wasn't really doing it. Hinduism. I had a friend whose family was you know, sort of Western Hindu practitioners. And I really loved that. I was very interested in that, but it wasn't quite getting it. So I was, you know, in search for a path. I knew that I wanted a path. I knew that I needed a path. But I was also very aware that it needed to fit certain criteria. It needed to not have a thrice omni creator God. I had absolutely no time or space for a God. I was and still identified as deeply atheistic on an ultimate existential sense. But I also needed it to be ritually rich. I needed it to have mythic, you know, depth and profundity. And I needed it to be reasonable. I needed it to be logical. I had deep problems with the irrationality of Christianity. I had problems with, you know, creation theory, with the young earth theory, the rejection of science and evolution and everything that we know to be true. That really disturbed me. And I wanted to find something that wasn't that. So, of course, when I encountered Buddhism, that was the golden ticket, you know, that was
particularly the Tibetan strain of Buddhism, because really there is a whole lineage of logic that coincides with mystery and magic in Tibetan Buddhism that is makes it, I think, pretty unique amongst the Buddhist possibilities, or let's say. I mean, you have a very strong shamanic other world dimension entities and all the rest of it, ritual, very intense and incredible rituals and beauty, but also this very practical logic, reason, emphasis on reason in terms of really critiquing the nature of reality and the Madhyamaka and so on. I think that must have been very satisfying to find that.
Yeah, and real profundity, you know, real profundity that, you know, when you look at it from any perspective, you can see that it's trying to get to the real core of the way things are. It's not profound in the sense that, oh, Jesus died for our sins. You know, for a Christian, that is the most profound statement that someone could make. Or for a Catholic, that, you know, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are the same. They're part of the same Trinity. These sorts of ideas are profound within their mythic worldview, but it's not really getting to the true profound nature of reality, in my opinion. And that was clear for me then, and it's still clear for me. Buddhism did that, even in the Tibetan tradition. You know, I was brought in more through initially through Zen and through you know, not formal Zen meditation, but experimenting with it on my own, and then getting absorbed into the Vipassana tradition through an insight meditation center in my hometown. So I started getting some guidance more from the sort of Vipassana, you know, insight meditation society approach, a little bit more psychologized, more Theravadan in its sort of orientation. And that was a good foundation for me. And I got, you know, a good year of guided meditation instructions as a 13-year-old before I ended up coming to Tibetan Buddhism. But then finding Tibetan Buddhism changed everything. Reading the hagiography of Padmasambhava, specifically the Lotus Born, Erik Pema Kunzong's book, his translation, that really, really enchanted me. And also a photo book that I would always flip through, Tibetan Buddhist Life by Don Farber. And that had a lot of nice images of Tibetan practitioners from various traditions. And through that, I was sort of, I was able to piece together that I felt a strong affinity for the Nyingma tradition and for the practice of Chut. From the first time I saw a photo of some, you know, yogis with their drums and reading a little bit about the practice itself, I was enthralled and knew that that was something that I needed to understand and to get involved in. Mm-hmm. And I was very fortuitous in this decision, because I literally went to my parents and said, I'm a Nyingma Tibetan Buddhist. I went to my school and my classmates and said, hello, everyone. I'm now a Nyingma Tibetan Buddhist. Had no idea what any of that meant. Didn't know what Nyingma meant. I just knew that it's connected with this guy. And there's also this practice over here that they seem to do sometimes. So that was for me enough. It wasn't until about, I think, 6 months later that I went to a little holistic expo at the fair fairgrounds, and I ran into a woman who was maintaining a stand with a bunch of Tibetan implements on it, which I had recognized from my book. And I asked her, I was like, is this a Tibetan Buddhist center that you're part of? And she said, yeah, we're a Tibetan Buddhist center. We're in Pagosa Springs, about an hour and a half away from where we were. I said, well, what tradition is it? And she said, oh, we're Nyingma. Do you know what that means? And I lost it. I was absolutely blown away that there was a center in the specific Tibetan Buddhist lineage that I had sort of unwittingly adopted for myself. And I begged my parents to take me there. We went on a September day in 2005. And we went to Taramandala, which is the center in Pagosa Springs, drove onto the land. There were no buildings at that time, and there was no one there. And we hadn't told anyone that we were coming. They had visiting hours. We were not in the visiting hours. And we just drove up to a yurt that had a car parked in front of it. And I went and knocked on the door, and a woman appeared. And I said, hello, hi, I'm Eric, I'm Nyingma. And she said, hi, I'm Sultram, it's nice to meet you. And I recognized that she was the resident teacher, and she invited me in and we had a conversation. I asked her to be my guru. She said yes, and gave me a copy of her book and some cassette tapes and sent me on my way. So that was, I was led directly into it. And I was led not only directly into Tibetan Buddhism, but specific lineage. It was a Nyingma center. Yeah, Lama Sultram is herself recognized as an emanation of Machi Klapdrin. She's a holder of the Chid tradition. And yes, those were the two pieces that had completely enchanted me when I first encountered this tradition. So I was really, I felt like it was fated. And I think my parents also felt like it was fated, which gave them a bit of confidence that I was doing the right thing and that they weren't losing their child to a cult or something. It was obvious that I was really invested and that there seemed to be some real connection here. So that was how I met the Dharma. I've been with Lama Sultram ever since. She's still my root teacher. But I spent a lot of years living on the land. I was trained really extensively in ritual arts, in shippening, and also being an umze, like a practice leader. I have a musical theater background. So all of those kinds of things were very easy for me to assimilate. And I got really deeply, deeply involved. It eventually took over my life pretty completely. I had been on track to be a musical theater actor. I had been in shows for many years. I was accepted to the most prestigious musical theater conservatory in America. And I was supposed to do that. That was my sort of path. But after a year at musical theater school, I realized that I just couldn't not be primarily invested in Tibetan Buddhism, that had to be my primary focus.
I'm tracking your biography, and there are certain nuggets here that just scream out to me. And it just feels like the synchronicity is undeniable. There's you're being led, and I mean, part of the thesis of your book will be that, there are other worlds than these. These are worlds that aren't just dominated by human beings, but at least the world of spirit beings, Buddhas and Bodhisattvas, at least that's one layer beyond the mere appearance of things. And of course, there's much more than that, but I can't help but characterize this section of your biography as one that's not being led. You're following the magic and you're being assisted.
That's what it felt like.
And I think that that's possible for anyone, but not everyone is primed for it.
No.
And this is, again, part of the argument of what does the mythic, there's going to be so many people, rightfully so, that are questioning and suspicious of mythology. They're going to just see it as a dispensable artifice of the past. But this is how a really rich life can be guided.
Yeah.
Mythology helped open up receptivity channels to you.
Yeah.
And you followed signs and you knocked on doors. And I haven't come across a person really who, at least as they make their way into spirituality or into my psychotherapy office, that isn't looking for a teacher, but not all of them know how to find one.
Yeah.
And certainly at finding one at such a young age, now that we have a snapshot of your biography, we see how it was you were already priming yourself very early on with these antenna or antennae. And really, like, you're just following the magic, and you find what you're looking for. And of course the story doesn't just end there, because then I think you probably have gone through a tremendous amount of refining. Like, it's always just positioned there as, here's the tradition. And then there is a whole phase of metabolization in which you sift through what it is that the acorn of your own soul needs, which makes it truly yours. So I keep part of the podcast is an explicit hope that people allow themselves to drop out of the certainty channel and embrace some of the myth again, embrace some of the magic, to allow their intuitions to lead them and to see, to start to recognize signs and to live what Jung would have called a symbolic life. And this is why I like astrology too. We're probably not going to have time to talk about it, although you have an extensive background in astrology. But astrology fosters this kind of symbolic way of viewing the world. It's not that there are just rocks flying in an atomic world out in the cosmos that inherently have meaning. We supply the meaning. And that meaning forms a language, as you said about Tolkien, that helps us navigate and make sense of the world in a way that actually deepens us, enlivens us, and activates something inside of us that propels us further into becoming more of who we are.
Yeah.
And I feel that that's already in this timeline, you're already there. By the time you meet Sultram Alioni, you're, what, how old are you, 17 or 18?
I was 13 years old. No,
14. 13, it's incredible. I mean, it's just uncanny. And then to have such, you know, to be thrust in such a way, and obviously you have a lot of discipline, and you're a man of incredible follow through. So you're given these opportunities and you seize them with reckless abandon. So you know, we're right. I'm hanging on by. I'm with you. Just keep luring us into your path. And make your way, if you will, into the next iteration, so we can come back into the book, I guess, because I want to make sure that you talk about your book.
Sure. Yeah, there was an important moment in 2009 between my initial trajectory of you know, going to musical theater school and moving to New York and being a chorus boy, which was my professional trajectory for many years. And then switching into pursuing more Tibetan studies more directly, specifically. I had attended a Drupchen at Taramandala. It was our first Drupchen, which is a great accomplishment ceremony, considered to be the most elaborate ceremony in Vajrayana. It involves many practitioners coming together for 10 days and doing basically 24/7 practice throughout that time, many different ritual procedures, many different dances and instruments, and you know, giant creations of mandalas and tormas and all kinds of ritual activities. It's a lot, but it's incredible. And it's really, you know, it creates the sort of Vajra world in front of you. You are in it, you are physically in it, and you're living it.
In the mandala.
You're completely in the mandala.
With
the
your Tolkien hairy feet, you're in
with
there.
My Tolkien hairy feet, which I do now have quite hairy feet, and I'm very grateful for that. It's my only hobbity feature that I retain physically. But yeah, I mean, that it was a real magical experience. And that was something I literally, the last morning of the Drupchen, we'd been there doing this for 10 days. We'd been preparing for months, learning dances and instruments and melodies and mudras and doing all of this stuff. We go through the whole ritual, final day. We wake up at 3 a.m. Everyone gets up and goes to the temple. We do practice all morning. The sun comes up. We have fire pujas. We take substances. We do not like psychedelic substances, but, you know, sacred substances, yada, yada. All finishes. I say goodbye to everyone. I hop on a red-eye flight, fly to Boston. The next morning, I start musical theater school with a bunch of my actors.
That's not gonna work.
No.
That is like getting dropped off a cliff.
It was a terrible, terrible idea. I'm so glad I did it, but my God, it was a terrible idea. So I immediately, it wasn't gonna fly. I knew immediately that it wasn't gonna be something that I could continue with. So after a year, I decided to drop out and go to Naropa in Colorado. And then after a year there doing, you know, Tibetan language and religious studies, I decided I wanted to do something completely different. And the opportunity arose to study Tibetan medicine. I had actually gotten sick myself, went to see a doctor, Dr. Nishala Gwinyinda in Boulder. And within a few days, she had cured me, and I was absolutely astounded by it. And I wanted to know more about it. And another sort of synchronistic moment, just a couple of weeks went by and I got a notification that her alma mater, the Shangsheng Institute, was accepting applications for a new Tibetan medicine cohort. So I informed my parents that I was again dropping out of school.
By now they're not surprised.
By now they're not surprised. They're still not thrilled, but they're definitely not surprised. And I tell them that I'm going to go to Tibetan medicine school. My mother, she's always been very interested in holistic medicine and so on. So I think she was happy on that sense. But I was dropping a degree program to go and do a certificate in Tibetan medicine, which was, you know, completely different life trajectory than what they thought I was going to be on or what I thought I was going to be on. So that, you know, that was the big change, I suppose, that really set the stage for everything else. You know, between my meeting Lama Sultram and now, it's been around 18 years that have elapsed. So I've done a lot in that time. And the Tibetan medicine training was definitely the sort of primary core of sort of restructuring my approach to my practice and my approach to the world. There was, you know, a through line through these, my main practice being chud, which it has been for a long time. And that was something that was really established at Taramandala. And then in Tibetan medicine, I was really—
Do you want to describe chud in a nutshell for people who might not be familiar with it?
Yeah, so chud was an 11th century Tibetan Buddhist tradition that was developed by Machi Klapdrin, who was a matriarch of this tradition. She's one of the few true historical Tibetan matriarchs to establish a whole lineage of Tibetan Buddhism. And her tradition was in large part inspired from Mahayana Buddhism, her study of the Prajnaparamita Sutra, especially, that really had informed her approach to creating a new Buddhist tradition. But she was also very much speaking to and relating to a Tibetan audience who hadn't yet fully found a method of relating with unseen beings. This was something that you can see from her writings was really a prominent topic at this point. If we look at Tibetan history objectively, at this point, the stories about Padmasambhava pacifying all of the spirits and converting them all to protectors and stuff, that hadn't yet been written. That came in the 12th, 13th century. In Machik's time, Tibetans didn't yet have that as the model for understanding how to relate with unseen beings. So her core practice of chud, of the lujin, the body offering, is a process on an outer level of going to places that scare us, especially haunted, spirited locations that are full of other than human beings who might be, you know, capricious sort of, you know, either frightening forces or benevolent forces, but they're out there, and you go into their domain and you make yourself vulnerable. And that's the sort of outer level of this practice. On an inner level, you are, you know, pacifying, you're sort of alleviating past karmas, you're resolving karmic debts with other beings, and also generating merit by making offerings to the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas and sentient beings and so on. But then the real core of the practice is severing egocentricity. It's severing our fundamental demon of self-clinging, of dakzin. So Machik talks a lot about demons, and chud in the, you know, 19th and early 20th century, most people in the West saw chud as an exorcism rite. It was an esoteric Tibetan exorcism ritual with these, you know, frightening magicians that would, you know, just cast away evil spirits with their daggers. And that was sort of the idea about what chud was. But that's not actually what chud was at all. Machik's approach to dealing with so-called gods and demons was fundamentally a paradigm of feeding instead of fighting. Mm-hmm. So instead of, you know, with demons especially, instead of you know, giving them extra energy by struggling against them and creating a further rift in our mind between these various fragmented aspects of our psyche, she advised feeding them, finding, you know, what they really need and feeding them to satisfaction. Mm-hmm. So my teacher, Lama Sultram, she's formalized the sort of psychological approach to this. You know, I think of it as there's a division that takes place with that recognition. Machik teaches that external beings like the Mamos and the Teorang and the Gyalpo and all these Tibetan spirits, those are not the real gods and demons. the real gods and demons are anything that inhibit our experience of freedom, that hinder us from being able to experience the nature of our own mind. So namely our afflictive mental states and fundamentally our unawareness to the real nature of reality. So there is this fork that takes place for a long time throughout Indo-European history, especially leading into Buddhism, at least, there's a sense that, you know, gods and demons are these external beings. There's the good guys and the bad guys. In Hinduism, you have the devas and asuras. Buddhism as well, there's this sort of division between the gods and anti-gods, which is itself a bit of a delusion. But this is the mentality we have. There's gods and demons, and they're out there, and they can hurt us, and they can drag us into terrible places, and this is where we live. Machik said, no, that's actually not the case. Those beings are not gods and demons. The only real gods and demons are your hopes and fears. They're the phenomena that exist in the space of your own mind. So Lama Soltram took this understanding and really elaborated on the psychological interpretation of this, understanding how to actually work with our own gods and demons, our hopes and fears, our addictions, our traumas, how to deal with those in an integrated way, through precisely that Jungian sort of ethic of, you know, not just imagining figures of light, but making the darkness conscious. So that was one side of it. But then there was another side. There's a strand that Machik sort of leaves hanging, or at least in people's perception of her teachings. And that is, what are those things then? What are those beings over there? If they're not gods and demons, what are they? Ah. And in the modern sort of Western Tibetan Buddhist movement, there has unfortunately been this myth that's developed that actually those spirits that the Tibetans talk about are just allegories for our human emotions. Mm. All they are is a symbolic representation of
Too reductionistic.
It completely removes the possibility that there is something outside of humans, that there are other beings with their own experiences. And of course, this is core to Buddhism. There are many non-human beings in Buddhism.
I'm getting chills. I'm getting chills because I'm a couple weeks out from moving my entire family to Bali. And of course, Bali is very tantric Hinduism. But the understanding amongst the local population is that they're constantly inhabited by a world of beings. In fact, talk about a world of enchantment. This population of people, this way of living is completely enchanted, so much so that your everyday interaction requires a conversation and a commitment to being in relation with them.
Exactly. I mean, we have the, you know, we're starting to realize, for instance, like the importance of consent in certain human activities, the fact that we actually have to have a relationship and a conversation in order to determine that certain kinds of relationships can take place. This is the case for all of us. It's not just the case in human relationships. We are in dynamic relationship with all other forms of life, including
First Nations also. I mean, First Nations absolutely lived in relation with a world of not just, I mean, as you say, human-centric, animals, deities, plants, the earth, I mean, everything, and so profound, so central.
Yeah, it is. The profundity of just this understanding, just this realization is so frequently overlooked, I think, especially in the Buddhist tradition, because we're so accustomed to jumping to those very high, lofty levels of absolute reality, and that's what profundity is. But we don't realize that we have spiritually bypassed one of the most enchanting components of what it means to be alive, and that is an earnest acknowledgement of other than human beings. You know, Machik's explanation for what those beings are the Buddhist explanation. They're sentient beings, full stop. They're not absolute gods. They're not absolute demons. They're not going to take you to the heavens. They're not going to drag you down to the hells. They're not always going to help you or always hurt you. They're other sentient beings, just like any of us. So we're in relationship with them. They don't have absolute existential control over us, but we're in relationship with them. So we should approach them with love and compassion. We shouldn't approach them with deification, demonization, or a complete dismissal of their existence. All of these are anthropocentric paradigms that bring us further away from a genuine experience of relationship. So this is the core of Machik's ontology. Is there's this clear delineation between what are real gods and demons, and then what are sentient beings, and how do we relate with each of them? And in both cases, we relate with them with love and compassion.
I remember being in Bodh Gaya for the Dalai Lama. This was before pandemic, maybe a year before the pandemic. It was 2018. The Dalai Lama was going to give the Yamantaka initiation. There were maybe 30 to 40,000 people in attendance, and we were at the onset of the ritual. And he stopped and he paused and he changed things up right on the dime. And then he gave a sub-commentary on it, which was there was supposed to be an aspect of the ritual that was driving away the evil spirits from the mandala.
Yeah.
And he paused and he said, you know, I've always done this ritual because it's part of the tradition, but now I see that it contradicts our intentionality here, which is to live in compassion.
That's great.
And so he said, what I'm going to do is actually invite all the malevolent spirits to stay with us and enjoy this nectar, because this is how to embody compassion for the onset of this ritual. And I, out of the 14 Dalai Lamas, he's probably the first to do such a thing. Absolutely. But I think that moment really speaks to what you're saying.
Yeah.
I mean, we're building a mandala. So it's an alternative paradigm. It's a completely, and in that paradigm, we're all self-generating as deity. And yet we're casting out. Yeah. It's like, you don't belong here. And the Dalai Lama stops and says, no, I mean, that completely contradicts the whole ethos. Yes. All those other spirits, number one, they do exist, as you're saying. And number two, I guess in terms of the magic LeBron, let's feed them. Let's feed them the nectar of altruism.
Yeah.
And I think that if we're going to take that as a metaphor, I mean, it was literal, but if we were going to make a statement about it in real life, I mean, we are now on a cusp of a major global transition. For the last few hundred years, people's movements have been, there has been a movement towards human right. There has been a movement towards people's right. There has been a great, a necessary destabilization.
Yeah.
Through all these sort of movements to correct imbalances of power. Yeah. And whether they be dominated by patriarchy or white supremacy or what have you, economic elitism. But we are now, what I'm sensing from you, and I'm going to open the door for you to take us through it, is those movements which have made so much gain in reorganizing how we see ourselves in relation to others are now going to take this next bold step, transhuman.
Yeah.
And I just think that that's with the Dalai Lama's little bit of symbolic and literal gesture there. This is medicine.
Yeah.
This is actually what heals.
Yeah, exactly. That Dalai Lama anecdote gave me chills. That's, I haven't heard that before. That's incredible. And such a great example of the Tibetan Buddhist ethic that really developed around the time of Machik Laptrin. I think I could be wrong about this, but I really feel that this is something that specifically arose in a Tibetan context, which is why we'll find a lot of Indic tantric works that don't have the same sort of the same ethic. They don't necessarily treat it in the same way. Machik's tradition specifically, in many of her practices, you know, she says not to exclude anyone. Everyone is included. Mm. Everyone is brought to the feast. The worst of the beings, the most malevolent and angry and needy beings are first and foremost. They're the
inclusivity. VIPs. What a powerful yeah. sentiment for the paradigm shift, right?
Absolutely. Which of course makes sense considering the animistic basis that Tibet had for the adoption of Buddhism. You know, in India, they had already, by the time the Buddha came around in, his sort of northeastern Indian context with folks like Mahavira and the Shramana movements in relation with Vedic Brahmanism, there was animistic animism is embedded in that. You know, Vedic Brahmanism did have, an animistic worldview, more so, I would say, even than Buddhism in certain respects. Jainism definitely had an animistic ethos. But Tibet, it was living, it was embodied, it was a part, a core part of the religious experience.
Taoist and Japan, too, strong animism.
Absolutely. What we find when we see this integration of, like, you know, Buddhist Tantra in Japan, also in Tibet, we see much more creative interpretations of what other sentient beings can look like. In Japan, there were multiple traditions that earnestly considered the sentience of plants, which is something that I talk about a lot in my book, because I think it's something that Buddhism kind of missed and got wrong initially. But it is corrected somewhat in these other traditions that Buddhism came into, because they were already so steeped in an ancestral animistic tradition. It's not that Machik Lapchen intentionally wrote animism into Buddhism, or, you know, was some kind of Bunpo priestess who was talking about Buddhism. That isn't the case. But the culture from which she came was deeply animistic and had been for thousands of years, most likely, definitely for many hundreds of years. And all of us initially were animistic. Animism is the original worldview. It preceded a belief in the afterlife. It preceded shamanic engagement. It preceded ancestor worship. It preceded the existence of gods. All of these things were preceded by animism. It is the most fundamental way that we can interface with a more than human world. That's all it is. It's just acknowledging that, yeah, we're humans, there's other beings that are non-humans, and we have to have relationships with them. Mm-hmm. But the way that it happened in Tibet and Japan was very interesting in this sense. And there was, I think, a bit more dynamism and flexibility in really making sense of these paradigms. So through Machik's teachings, which were then, they infiltrated all of the different schools of Tibetan Buddhism, even though her own tantra sort of practice lineage dwindled a little bit as its own sort of monolithic entity. But it was in other places, and that ethic really started to sort of seep throughout Buddhism, Tibetan Buddhism, to the point that it's pretty widely considered that chuddha is sort of the gold standard for relating with spirits. And what that teaches is that they're sentient beings. You should feed them instead of attacking them. You should love them as you love your own children, because they've been your mother in a past life. And also a recognition that the real gods and demons are not them. The real gods and demons are the mental afflictions that we experience within the immediacy of our own awareness. Arising from our unawareness of the real nature of reality. That's the demon. That's what we need to cut. It's not those beings. We need to help them and love them. You know, it's ironic, because we originally thought, you know, like Alexander David Neal, when she writes about chud, it's specifically this, you know, brutal, macabre exorcism rite that's, you know, totally violent and wrathful. But the reality is that chud is the most peaceful
loving
practice. It's the epitome of a peaceful practice. You know, it's you're not in any sense attacking others. There are some wrathful chud practices, but those are only engaged if the peaceful methods don't work. The first and most important method of engagement is always through love and compassion.
We could talk for hours. I'm going to ask you to at least close the loop on this conversation. I think one of the things that appeals to me about the direction that you're taking in the book, and maybe you can spark some interest among the listeners now as we head into, eagerly awaiting its release. In what way is this sensitivity towards the unseen medicinal? In what way will it really be healing on the individual and on the collective level?
Yeah. So on an individual level, this is an antidote for isolation. It's an antidote for our sense of alienation from nature. You know, we talk about the environment as a place, as our home, for instance, which is very romantic and very nice. But it's not a place, it's a community. It's a community of beings. There are other beings that comprise the place that we see as our, you know, sort of fixed home. But it's a community. It's a wild, complex, interconnected universe of different forms of life and different kinds of sentient beings all interacting with one another. So on a personal level, that itself is an enchanting experience. You know, it's really at the heart of enchantment, regardless of what form of enchantment or fantasy or myth or whatever you're engaging in, is to have authentic relationship with other kinds of beings. You know, to speak the languages of animals and trees. That is far closer to the heart of what fairy story tries things to get at than, you know, trying to appeal to the gods or trying to change your fate or something like that. It's an organic, immediate level of natural enchantment that arises through relationship. So, you know, we know we have plenty of scientific data to show us that being in nature is deeply psychologically and physiologically beneficial for us. It's you know, essential for our health. This is what we were evolved to do. We evolved to exist in nature, to engage with plants, to climb on trees, to, you know, be in nature itself, to be fully involved in it and engaged with it. And we've moved away from that. So it will give us the ability to experience that basic sense of meaning and involvement. On a communal level, the book is essentially, it is itself based on the diagnostic process that the Buddha uses for like the Four Noble Truths. So that is a medical paradigm. It's a medical paradigm that was used by the Buddha, is used by Vedic physicians. It was used in the ancient Greek world. This idea that we begin with a diagnosis, we establish its etiology, we look at its pathogenesis, how did it develop? We look at the prognosis, and then we establish a treatment. This is the basic process really by which sentient beings evaluate issues in their lives. We all do this on a micro level constantly all day long. So in doing this in relation to our chief problem, our main elephant in the room, which is the Anthropocene and climate change and global warming. So looking at that directly from a sort of medicalized, you know, diagnostic paradigm, that was the inception for the sort of theoretical basis of the book. So the diagnosis, we know what the diagnosis is. It's climate destruction, ecological meltdown, you know, global warming. We're not very good at establishing a single term for it because global warming ignores all the other climate components that are going wrong. And climate change is very docile sounding. It's not just change and it's not a fever. It's absolute metastasizing, festering, deep chronic terminal illness that we're dealing with. So that's our diagnosis. The etiology of why this happened, in my opinion, this comes down to anthropocentrism. It comes down to the formalized development of a logical paradigm of anthropocentrism, which we really find in the ancient Greek world. Plato and Aristotle sort of started this movement, and then that became absorbed into Christianity, and then later into many sort of enlightened Western philosophical movements, and ultimately to where we are now. We still basically believe the same things about plants and animals that Aristotle told us to believe over 2,000 years ago. And that's very problematic because it's not based in empirical knowledge. It's not based in observation. It's based in delusion. And he even kind of knew that. He knew he wasn't a very good botanist, for instance. So his assertion that plants are completely inert biological automata with absolutely no sensory awareness whatsoever, he knew that maybe wasn't true. He had a student, Theophrastus, who was a much better botanist, who himself was able to determine that this wasn't true and that plants have a sensory experience. They have an awareness component to their reality. But as we tend to do, it's not always the people with the best ideas that we listen to. It's the celebrities that have the most endorsement. And also the works that end up surviving over time are selected to survive over time. You know, we lost 99% of Latin literature in the early centuries of the Christian era because Christians destroyed them to scrub heresy from the written record. And Greek works had a very similar fate. Everything tended to go to the Middle East. It survived there. Arabic and Persian, you know, scientists and philosophers, they developed these ideas in a much more robust way. But in Europe, we were left with sort of the bare minimum of what we thought was the Aristotelian and Platonic corpus. And one of the things we learned from that is that animals and plants are completely non-vital. They don't really exist. They're just robots that were placed there in the Christian era by God for us to use as resources and food. So this is a basic delusion that hopefully people can see is not very useful in the modern era. The idea that these are just unliving resources that were literally designed for us to exploit opens the door for unbounded exploitation. And that's precisely what we've done. So acknowledging anthropocentrism as the ideological root of climate change today, of our ecological destruction, our paradigms of exploitation, I think that that's really essential. And understanding the ways that progressed through religious movements especially, but also later philosophical movements and ultimately the hard sciences, is really important for us to grasp, in the same way that understanding the historical roots of the concept of hell or Satan is useful for us to realize that we don't actually need to worry about hell and Satan. So that historical context is something that I favor really strongly in the book, and try to put that front and center for people to understand why we believe the things that we believe. Mm-hmm. We don't believe that animals and plants are agentless, thoughtless, instinct-driven machines because that's empirically true, or because it's reasonable, or because that's what all the scientists are showing us is the case. It's the complete opposite of what we're being shown is actually true. So what do we do with that? What do we do with that knowledge? Our prognosis is significantly dependent upon what we do with that knowledge. So, you know, if we choose to acknowledge that we made a mistake, if we choose to right some of the wrongs that we perpetuated in the name of that delusion, most of all, arguably being the complete decimation of indigenous cultures that adhered to animistic worldviews on the basis that they were so primitive and stupid that they couldn't see the difference between a person and a thing. It's, we can't just go from that to appropriating indigenous animistic traditions to try to fix our problems, because there was a lot of harm that was caused in between those two points, and we have to acknowledge that directly. So My proposal is that we all re-engage an animistic worldview. This is essential for all of us. It's essential on a communal level to be on a path to recovery, to actually find a way to get out of our current crisis. We're never going to get out of it if the only way that we can talk about trees is as carbon sinks, or if the only way that we can talk about animals is some vague notion of biological diversity and the importance of biological diversity for the planet. These aren't compelling emotional arguments. These aren't mythically ingrained. We have no sense of how that relates with our experience or how we're in relationship with them. If we can see that, you know, for starters, the fact that plants are sentient beings in much the same way that animals are sentient beings, and that we cannot create a logical division between animal sentience and plant sentience, then that totally changes the terms of our conversations about climate change. Deforestation in the Amazon becomes a multi-compounded ethical conundrum because of the treatment of plants, the treatment of animals, the treatment of humans, and the treatment of the biological or, you know, multi-compound organisms that result from those relationships. We're destroying all of them. And that by itself is an ecological and ethical conundrum. That's an ethical crisis. We don't even need to deal with the future ramifications of these problems on human societies, especially on, you know, sort of developed nations that have air conditioning and some sort of protections against environmental crises. This is the point. This is something that we really have to come around to. And the only way that we're going to come around to it is through stories. It's through changing our mythic worldview. It's changing the way that we actually conceptualize our place in the world. Only by doing that are we going to be able to actually achieve any kind of change.
Well, that is a wonderful coming full circle, because we spent the majority of the top of our conversation exploring the mythical dimension of life. And here you're coming, not only locating it within the ecological demise of the planet, but suggesting that without a mythological land bridge to reorganize our relationship, basically it's just moving furniture on the Titanic. It's not going to be enough. I would say the scientifically grounded activism that is out there, I'm sensing that in your estimation, that's just going to fall short, and it's not nearly enough. It's not sophisticated. It's not seeing the root cause clearly, nor is it addressing it in any kind of meaningful way. And so this is a paradigm first, or perspective first, or what we'd call in Buddhism view first. This is about right view.
Precisely. This is our worldview. When we say view as if it's just a distinct thing. It's worldview. It is our worldview. That is what Buddhism talks about in establishing right view. It's establishing the right view of the world, the right view of phenomenal reality as it exists. And that's something that's the first step on the Noble Eightfold Path. That is the first step in our treatment, both in our treatment of our existential disease of suffering, but also most certainly our disease of ecological collapse. We have to deal with the problem on the level of the worldview, because even 2,000 years ago, people were using the justification that plants and animals aren't really alive to exploit plants and animals and to exploit natural environments and resources. Our whole way of conceptualizing the problem is itself part of the problem. No matter how we dance around it and try to, you know, plant more trees so that we can sequester more carbon, or, you know, we can try to preserve animal populations in a certain place, as long as we think of this in such sort of mechanistic terms, especially anthropocentric mechanistic terms, that in which they only exist for our purposes, we're fucked.
Yes. I guess, you know, I'm going to just play devil's advocate as we conclude here. I'm not going to make this the final comment, but if you look out on the world, right, at least in the geopolitical mess that we're in, or even just locally in the United States, I mean, we're talking about white supremacy and racial injustice. I mean, it's hard enough to get our heads around just the delusions that occur between people. What you're asking us to think about or to consider seems like a magnificent leap. I mean, what ways have you thought about that in terms of the release and positioning this book we can't even get along with our neighbors. What's being asked of here is to then re-envision ourselves in our relationship with the entire biosphere. Of course, someone like me loves that. I love that idea. I mean, I want to raise my kids 8 and 5 right now and in that very ethos. Because I think you have to start young if you want to have a chance. And I want to make sure that they get the opportunity to have the mythological dimension of life present just as easily as rational science. But it is a hard leap. What do you say to that?
Before I say that, I do want to say that an important point, I think, also is the fact that science is enchanting. Science can point us towards phenomenally enchanting realities about the nature of our world. You know, the study of evolution, the study of biology, the study of astrophysics, etc., that can enchant us.
Carl Sagan was an enchanting figure. I mean, he absolutely really was. Yeah.
We have this, you know, we have this myth, another myth that we live by, which is that as soon as you understand how something works, it ceases to be enchanting, it ceases to be magical. And that's just not true at all. We can know a great deal about something, and that can actually make it far more enchanting. It's, you know, the reason that certain myths speak to us is because we can tell that they're speaking from a place of truth. And the more aligned the myth is with the truth, the more powerful it's going to be. So we really, you know, we have to be careful of falling into any sort of dualism that posits that there's a separation fundamentally between science and enchantment, or even myth and science. Mm-hmm. We need science to inform our myths, and then we need our myths to expand the breadth of what we perceive to be possible. You know, that imaginative space that comes from an experience of enchantment, that pushes our boundaries, it pushes us into new frontiers, which then precipitate into new scientific revolutions and discoveries, which then do the same thing. That would be the organic process. That's how we can actually, you know, get into a cycle of more enduring progress, as opposed to falling into these, you know, exhausting patterns of just accumulating knowledge, throwing it all away, new paradigm, accumulate knowledge, throw it away, new paradigm, etc. So that's just one thing that I wanted to throw out there. But then as to the core question, which I think is very, very important for us to be aware of on many levels, not least of all being an acknowledgement of the impact of our past crimes on Indigenous peoples, and the fact that there's far too many, I think, you know, white Westerners who feel like they can now just go and appropriate an Indigenous animistic tradition and sort of, you know, wear the robes and take on the identity without acknowledging the grave harm that had been caused just, you know, 100 years ago and even still today. So that's something that I think is important. But also really seeing that the root causes are fundamentally the same, regardless of the paradigms that we use to separate ourselves and others, the production of a master identity at the center, and then a bunch of others that are basically revolving around that master identity, that is a very core delusion that we have. You know, whether we use species, which is at least a scientifically identifiable thing. Species do exist on some level that we can determine through, you know, the ability to procreate and so on. But we have this idea that it's between species. So humans must be in the middle and everyone else is out there. That's the anthropocentrism is the species equivalent of white supremacy, as opposed to racism, which is speciesism. These are paradigms of dividing things up. But then the assertion that one of them is central and everyone else is lesser, that's this master identity complex. And that's at the center of everything. That's at the center of white supremacy. It's at the center of patriarchy. It's in the center of ethnocentrism. These are all a part of the same constellation of delusions that we have. Mm-hmm. What is compounded when we talk about something like race is the fact that race itself is strictly a cultural construct. It's strictly a social and cultural constructed identity. There's no physiological or genetic basis for what we think of as race. We are all humans. There's one human race. There are different, you know, genetic and ethnic, lineages that arise from that. But race itself is a political and social construct that doesn't have any absolute reality. So the construct of whiteness, for instance, it's open to interpretation, which is very convenient for a white supremacist orientation, because then you can keep whoever you want in the in-group and then throw everyone else out who you want to throw out. But the belief that this is a useful paradigm for breaking beings up, for breaking humans up and looking at them in categories, is deeply diluted, because that isn't a fundamental reality that we can isolate on some sort of a physiological level. That being said, because we've asserted a paradigm of race for hundreds of years, more than that in certain ways, but our logical paradigm of what race is a relatively recent phenomenon. But because we've done that for so long, and because we've oppressed and objectified and exploited people on that basis, we have to acknowledge it as a reality. It's a myth, but it is a myth that has incredible power and influence in the world that we live in. So we have to acknowledge the crimes that have been committed in the name of racism. We have to look at the systemic ways that our societies have been built upon a white supremacist model, in the same way that it's been built upon a patriarchal model, and also on an anthropocentric model, that there is a central pillar of the white straight man that is here at the middle of everything, and then everyone else is secondary. That has to go. But we can't just knock down one, we can't just go from one side. We can't just attack the gender issue. We can't just attack the racial issue. We can't just attack the anthropocentrism issue. We have to deal with the whole tendency that we have to place a master identity in the middle, usually one that we belong to, and then put everyone else outside of that. These are distinctly related. You know, Val Plumwood and a lot of people have noted that very frequently in societies that denigrate nature, they almost always also denigrate women. They perceive women as being lesser than men. These two things go hand in hand. Even with Platonic philosophy, he very much creates this divide between the masculine, intellectual, you know, transcendent world and the feminine, base, earthly, material world of feeling. It's that basic schism between reason and feeling, masculinity and femininity, that so much Platonic philosophy is built on, and then later Cartesian philosophy. But it's that basic split. It's the subject-object fixation. But we have to address all of the different permutations of it. We have to look at white supremacy. We have to look at patriarchy. We have to look at anthropocentrism. And we have to find ways to dissemble and break down all of these broken systems.
Hear, hear. What an amazing contribution that you're making to this sort of interrelated, interdisciplinary sort of attempt to get to the root of the problem and provide some solutions. Thank you so much for your body of work. That was a engaging life history. I think you really opened up portals for me that I think we were able to track your biography in more, let's call it, it was a magical numtar that led into the book. So I want to make sure that we're going to have your website and the title of the book in the show notes. I want to thank you for your passion, because it's clear and evident, but also your acumen and you're really a sharp Manjushri. And it was a real pleasure to engage with you, and looking forward to future dialogues. So on behalf of myself and all the listeners, thank you so much for participating so richly and authentically on the Wisdom Keeper podcast.
No, thank you so much for having me. It's been great. Definitely look forward to further conversations.
So we'll look forward to the potential release of the book in spring of 2023. Yes. That is the title once more.
Unseen Beings, How We Forgot the World is More Than Human. And there's a bunch more in here that you know, I didn't touch on. I talk a lot about medicine, for instance, and the connections between ecological health and infectious diseases. So there's a whole bunch in there, many cans of worms to open. So I hope that everyone enjoys those.
Yeah, we'll keep some of it. We'll just tease a little bit so that we can generate interest. Thanks so much, Erik. Take good care. Until soon. All best wishes.
Thank you for listening to the Wisdom Keeper podcast. If you've enjoyed this presentation of sacred knowledge, kindly like, subscribe, review, and share our podcast and video series on YouTube with your network, so that more people can benefit from these teachings, and together we can create a brighter future. If you're interested in my online courses, our community membership, and pilgrimages I lead, consider visiting the Contemplative Studies program at gradualpath.com. Until we gather again, all best wishes.